Simon & Schuster Audio presents Immigration Wars, Forging an American Solution by Jeb Bush and Clint Bolick. Read by Skipp Sudduth and introduced by the authors with an epilogue read by Jeb Bush.
Preface by Jeb Bush. Immigration to me is personal. It means my wife and family, as it has for countless Americans since our country was founded. In 1970, on the central plaza of the town of León, Mexico, I met a beautiful young woman with the beautiful name of Columba Garnica de Gallo. After spending a few weeks in León, I knew I wanted to marry her. It seems crazy in this era of young people waiting for years until they decide to marry, but I tell our children it was what people used to call love at first sight. A year later, Columba moved from León to Southern California, where she went to school and worked. We carried on a long-distance romance for almost 4 years until we were married in the Newman Catholic Center at the University of Texas in Austin in February 1974. Thanks to my wife, I became bicultural and bilingual, and my life is better because of it. For the first time in my life, I learned what the immigrant experience was, and I grew to appreciate her desire to learn English and embrace American values while still retaining her love for the traditions of Mexico. My wife became an American citizen in 1979, and she was able to vote for her father-in-law for President of the United States. Her citizenship ceremony and the many I have participated in subsequently are some of the most rewarding experiences of my life. It is a fundamentally American experience to see people of every nationality, every background, all coming together to swear their loyalty to our great country. Most have tears of joy in their eyes, and all of them aspire to a better life than what they left behind. That has been true of all immigrants to America from the beginning. I'm writing this book because I believe that a good immigration policy is necessary to live up to the values that make our country truly exceptional. At the age of 24, Columba and I moved to Caracas, Venezuela, along with our son George, who was 18 months old, and our daughter Noelle, who was 3 months, in order to open a representative office for Texas Commerce Bank. The job required me to travel throughout much of South America, and as a business experience, it was terrific for a guy my age. However, living overseas quickly made me appreciate the United States of America a lot more. It became clear to me that our country's exceptional nature comes from its openness, its dynamism, and a set of values that allow it to embrace a rich diversity without tearing us asunder. And then we moved to our beloved Miami. That amazing city, in and of itself, is another reason I decided to write this book. On January 1, 1981, my family and I moved to Miami to start a new life. Miami is an incredibly diverse metropolitan area with large immigrant communities from many countries. Today, Miami-Dade County has a population of 2.6 million people, 51% of them foreign-born. There is no other large community in America close to that percentage. Miami also has a higher-than-average percentage of participation in the military, and I can attest to its patriotic nature. Miami's immigrants have made my hometown a vibrant, dynamic, and exciting place to live, and that in turn has made it a magnet for even more immigration from inside and outside our country. Because I was the son of the Vice President, and later, of course, President George H.W. Bush, and living in an immigrant community, many people came to see me hoping I could help them with their immigration problems. I had never before witnessed the tragedy our immigration system had become. It is incredibly cumbersome, complex, opaque, sometimes capricious, and downright bureaucratic. I know from personal experience how expensive and slow it can be. I did my best trying to help people with legitimate claims, but it broke my heart seeing people languish inside the system with their paper files lost in some far-off place. It angered me that our great country can't seem to organize itself effectively regarding immigration as other countries do. Miami-Dade also has borne the brunt of the negative side of immigration. Our first few years in Miami, we saw the cost of unchecked immigration. the costs created by the minority of Cuban immigrants who arrived with the Mariel boat lift in 1980 were enormous in terms of the crime wave they created and the social costs they imposed. In addition, Miami became the center of narco trafficking, which added huge burdens to our community. So you see, I know firsthand what happens when the federal government is lax in enforcing our immigration laws. I also know firsthand the good that comes when the federal government makes border enforcement a high priority. In 1982, I called my dad to say that there was a drug dealer living on our same block. Neighbors said he had been bragging about importing cocaine from Colombia. I called after there was screaming from his wife, who had been locked out of their house in the middle of the night. The Reagan-Bush administration responded to many similar calls for action, and the drug trade was dramatically curtailed in Miami because of the federal, state, and local task force headed up by Vice President Bush and Attorney General Ed Meese. In the early 2000s, the George W. Bush administration dramatically reduced the flow of drugs from Colombia and the Caribbean into South Florida, using the Coast Guard and Navy. That was done with the full cooperation of the state of Florida. After Attorney General Janet Reno refused to accept a partnership, we proposed to help the federal government with their duties to enforce immigration laws of our country. In June of 2002, Attorney General John Ashcroft signed an agreement creating the first 287G cross-designation program in the country. Florida was the first state to get the feds to allow local and state law enforcement officers to be trained to act on behalf of Border Patrol and other federal law enforcement officials. I've always felt that this effort could be expanded dramatically and lessen the frustration that our local and state officials have regarding the inability of the federal government to combat the crimes of illegal immigrants. Three successful initiatives point the way to how to get border security right: the Vice President's Task Force of the 1980s, the federal-state efforts to control the importation of drugs in the early 2000s, and the cooperative agreement to extend the reach of immigration officials using state and local resources. As governor, I saw the impact of immigration policy on my state and the country. On September 11, 2001, America was changed forever by the attacks on New York City and Washington, D.C. Four of the 19 terrorists got their pilot's licenses in Florida. 10 of the terrorists had valid Florida-issued identifications. Some only received ID cards, and some had driver's licenses. 3 of the 19 had valid visas that had expired. Clearly, we had been too complacent as a nation. Beyond its relation to border enforcement and homeland security, immigration was woven into most of the issues I dealt with during my 8 years as governor, and most prominently, the economy. Florida's three largest industries, hospitality, construction, and agriculture, could not endure without immigrant workers. The 80 million visitors a year, the $8.26 billion of agriculture produced, and the construction business — Florida is historically one of the top three home building states in the country — will all be impacted unless we achieve comprehensive immigration reform. The jobs that will be lost and the opportunities that will be missed won't affect only immigrant workers. The economic livelihood of all Floridians will be hurt. The same applies to most regions of the United States. As we all know, the economic livelihood of our great country is at greater risk than it has been at any time in the last 50 years. The aging of our population — and at 60 years old, I'm part of that population — is a demographic time bomb that is shaking the sustainability of our savings for retirement, the viability of the entitlement system, and our ability to create robust economic growth. Consequently, the Social Security system is experiencing a declining worker-to-beneficiary ratio, which will fall from 3.3 to 1 in 2005 to 2 to 1 in 2040, according to the Social Security Administration. All of this brings us to the reason why we've written this book. In order to restore sustained economic growth going forward, we need an immigration strategy that opens our doors to young, aspirational people from all over the world so that they can pursue their dreams in our country. The United States of America has always been one of the few countries that can successfully do this. This will require public leadership. It will require breaking out of the gridlock of Washington, D.C. It will require new thinking, focused on the realities and opportunities of 2013 and beyond. I hope this book can help people see that through reforming our immigration system, we can restore America's promise and greatness. Finally, there's little Georgia. My youngest son, Jeb Jr., married his lovely wife, Sandra, a little more than 3 years ago. She's a Canadian citizen whose parents are of Iraqi nationality and moved to Toronto in the 1970s. Jeb met her in London. Her mother lives in Amman, Jordan, and her stepfather is from New Zealand. My precious granddaughter, Georgia Helena Walker Bush, is going on 2 now, and she's the joy of my life. 20 years from now, like millions of other Americans, she'll be asked by census takers what her race or ethnicity is. I'm certain she'll say not applicable or not relevant. But the identity politics that pervades our society currently makes us ask, what is she? By what hyphenated form of American should she be called? In reality, Georgia is an American with a diverse heritage. She will be taught to love her country and all of that rich heritage. My hope is that she'll be trilingual at least. Perhaps hers will be the new face of America, a nation that is always capable of changing for the better. But we cannot allow our dysfunctional political system and the political correctness of our times to stymie the great American tradition by which values, rather than race or ethnicity, define what it is to be an American. Fixing our immigration system won't solve all of our country's problems, even by the time Georgia grows up. But we owe it to the children of her generation to give this challenge our best efforts.
Preface by Clint, Bolick. I grew up in the 1960s and 70s in a segregated suburb in northern New Jersey. Many of my friends' parents or grandparents were European immigrants, mainly from Poland and Italy. But rarely, if ever, did I encounter a darker-skinned immigrant. My brother is 14 years older than I, and he was a rebel from the beginning. In defiance of my father's advice, Jerry joined the Marines just as the Vietnam War was heating up. Through a combination of luck and intransigence, my brother managed to serve 4 years in the Marines in the mid-1960s without being sent to Vietnam. Instead, he spent much of the war in Hawaii, where he met and fell in love with Irma, a second-generation Filipino-American from San Francisco. In my eyes, Irma was beautiful and even exotic. Shortly after she and Jerry married, my father died, and my mother's sister and I moved for a year to the Bay Area, where we were immersed in Irma's family. In contrast to our own white-bred family, her family was huge, boisterous, matriarchal, passionate, emotional.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.